Sorcerer's Stone. The Sorcerer's Stone is a legendary substance with astonishing powers. It can transform any metal into pure gold and produces the elixir of life, which will make the drinker immortal. The only stone currently in existence belongs to Mr. Nicholas Flamel, the noted alchemist, who last year celebrated his 665th birthday.
Let's see how this tastes, guys. I never tried this. This is my very own version of London Fog. I used an English tea that I bought a while ago, and I put some creamer in there, and I put some whipped cream on top. I'm going to try it with a spoon because if I don't, I'll end up with a whipped cream nose. So let's try it. Well, actually, maybe if I push some of the to the side. Oh my god, what a mess. I guess it might be just the tea, but it's okay. It's just okay. Maybe I needed to... Oh yes, that's what I forgot. I forgot to add some vanilla essence and some sugar.
For a spoonful of sugar helps the medicine go down in a most delightful way.
But it's not bad, actually. It's not too bad. If you've ever tried bubble tea, then you might like something like this. I'm always experimenting in the kitchen, and sometimes it turns like a freaking disaster. So today is Nicholas Flamel, chapter 13 of HP. I have Hogsmeade back there. I think that's where the kids go shopping, if I'm not mistaken. I don't know. I forget. I'm not sure. And then I also lit a hot cocoa and cream candle from Bath & Body Works, you guys. It just smells like the best, like, cup of hot chocolate. Very strong throw. I think that's what candle aficionados say, and it's just very good. Yeah, so I don't know. I'm definitely gonna give you guys that as a recommendation. Maybe they'll come out with it during the semi-annual sale or during the fall or winter season again. But yes, I wanted to just jump right in as per usual. I'm not sure who Nicholas Flamel is. I was trying to think of the first movie and try to remember exactly who this person could be, but I'm like, are they very close to the story of Voldemort? I'm not sure. Okay, so chapter 13, Nicholas Flamel. I keep calling him Nick Flamel. Chapter 13, Nicholas Flamel. Oh my gosh. I know, I'm gonna have it edited. Why am I showing it to you like that? Like we've never done Harry Potter before. Like here you guys go. So silly. It looks so cozy. There's somebody in a cape and it looks like they might be in the Forbidden Forest at night. I see a little moon. So this is very intriguing. I can't wait to find out what's gonna happen next. Oh yes, and just to super quickly recap, the last thing that we ended up doing was the Mirror of Erised, and if you don't know, now you know. One of Biggie's famous songs. Such a fun song. It's like, yeah. And we also did a Quidditch, and that was a lot of fun too, so just so you guys know where we might be at. And of course, the playlist will be linked in the description box as well as in the cards. Shoot, I always forget. I think it's here. Chapter 13, Nicholas Flamel. Dumbledore had convinced Harry not to go looking for the Mirror of Erised again. And for the rest of the Christmas holidays, the invisibility cloak stayed folded at the bottom of his trunk. Harry wished he could forget what he'd seen in the mirror as easily, but he couldn't. He started having nightmares. Over and over again, he dreamed about his parents disappearing in a flash of green light while a high voice cackled with laughter. That has to be... Oh my gosh, I was gonna say Dumbledore. That has to be... Lord Voldemort, right? Cackling with laughter, green light. Okay. You see, Dumbledore was right. That mirror could drive you mad, said Ron when Harry told him about these dreams. Hermione, who came back the day before term started, took a different view of things. She was torn between horror at the idea of Harry being out of bed, roaming the school three nights in a row, if Filch had caught you, and disappointment that he hadn't at least found out who Nicholas Flamel was. So she's like, I want to know the mystery, yo. They had almost given up hope. of ever finding Flamel in a library book, even though Harry was still sure he'd read the name somewhere. Once term had started, they were back to skimming through books for 10 minutes during their breaks. Harry had even less time than the other two because Quidditch practice had started again. Wood was working the team harder than ever. Even the endless rain that had replaced the snow couldn't dampen his spirits. The Weasleys complained that Wood was becoming a fanatic, but Harry was on Wood's side. If they won their next match against Hufflepuff, they would overtake Slytherin in the house championship for the first time in 7 years. Quite apart from wanting to win, I love that. I feel like I've read that before in this book. Quite apart from being blah, blah, blah. I have to think about it. Yeah, I guess this is the way this author, Rowling, writes. Quite apart from, quite apart from wanting to win, Harry found that he had fewer nightmares when he was tired out after training. Then, during one particularly wet and muddy practice session, Wood gave the team a bit of bad news. He'd just gotten very angry with the Weasleys, who kept dive bombing each other and pretending to fall off their brooms. "Will you stop messing around?" he yelled. "That's exactly the sort of thing that'll he loses this match. Snape's refereeing this time, and he'll be looking for any excuse to knock points off Gryffindor." George Weasley really did fall off his broom at these words. "Snape's refereeing?" he spluttered through a mouthful of mud. "When has he ever refereed a Quidditch match? He's not going to be fair if we might overtake Slytherin." The rest of the team landed next to George to complain, too. Like, like a crowd of angry British children. "It's not my fault," said Wood. "We've just got to make sure we play a clean game so Snape hasn't got an excuse to pick on us." Which was all very well, thought Harry. But he had another reason for not wanting Snape near him while he was playing Quidditch. The rest of the team hung back to talk to one another as usual at the end of practice, but Harry headed straight back to the Gryffindor common room where he found Ron and Hermione playing chess. Chess was the only thing Hermione ever lost at. Oh, that's so cool. You know, a little bit of, like, you can't be Miss Perfect all the time, you know? So this is the only thing she's ever lost at, something Harry and Ron thought was very good for her. A little bit of humble pie, okay? Oh my gosh, it smells like hot chocolate in here. That candle is so permeating. Is that the right way to say that? That candle permeates the space with its beautiful aroma. Okay, so let's continue. Which was all very well, thought Harry, but he had another reason for not wanting Snape near him while he was playing Quidditch. The rest of the team hung back to talk to one another as usual at the end of practice, but Harry headed straight back to the Gryffindor common room, where he found Ron and Hermione playing chess. Chess was the only thing Hermione ever lost at, something Harry and Ron thought was very good for her. "Don't talk to me for a moment," said Ron when Harry sat down next to him. "I need to concentrate." He caught sight of Harry's face. "What's the matter with you? You look terrible." Speaking quietly so that no one else would hear, Harry told the other two about Snape's sudden, sinister desire to be a Quidditch referee. "Don't play," said Hermione at once. Oh, that she, why would she say it like, "don't play," you know? Like, "don't play." Get it? Okay. Oh god. You know, you just put your essence on these characters when you're reading, and then you have to reread and reread. It's like read red when you read a sentence. You're not sure if it's read or red. Okay.
It says lead. Like lead balloon.
I believe it also was pronounced lead.
That gets under my skin a little bit. Okay, "don't play," said Hermione at once.
"Say you're ill," said Ron.
"Pretend to break your leg," Hermione suggested.
"Really break your leg," said Ron.
"Run downhill, then climb a tree."
"No, punch him in the bill."
"And then run in zigzags."
"I can't," said Harry. "There isn't a reserve seeker. If I back out, Gryffindor can't play at all."
At that moment, Neville toppled into the common room. How he had managed to climb through the portrait hole was anyone's guess, because his legs had been stuck together with what they recognized at once as the leg locker curse. He must have had to bunny hop all the way up to Gryffindor Tower. Everyone fell over laughing except Hermione, who leapt up and performed the counter curse. Neville's legs sprang apart and he got up to his feet trembling.
"What happened?"
Hermione asked him, leading him over to sit with Harry and Ron.
"Malfoy," said Neville shakily. "I met him outside the library. He said he'd been looking for someone to practice that on."
"Go to Professor McGonagall," Hermione urged Neville.
"Report him."
Neville shook his head.
"I don't want more trouble," he mumbled.
"You've got to stand up to him, Neville,"
said Ron. He's used to walking all over people, but that's no reason to lie down in front of him and make it easier. There's no need to tell me I'm not brave enough to be in Gryffindor. My boy's already done that, Neville choked out.
Harry felt in the pocket of his robes and pulled out a chocolate frog.
All right, we're gonna have to stop the presses. Stop the presses!
Okay, look what I have. I got this at Barnes & Noble a while ago. Oh, shoot. It says here, new characters, collect them all. Card may vary per pack. Yes, it's chocolate frog. 90 calories. It says here, this guy is the Hengist of Woodcroft. Hengist? Hengist? What does that mean? Anyway. Oh, you guys. These creatures. And me. Just snow. Oh, I'm trembling. Oh, I don't know if I can eat this. I don't think I can. I don't think I can eat this. I know it's chocolate.
That's rotten luck. I've only got one good jump in them to begin with.
Having to touch it. Trembling. I'm putting it on top of my record player and it'll be over here, but...
Besides, it's the card you want.
Cool, I got Godric Gryffindor. Gryffindor.
It says here, one of the four famous founders of Hogwarts School of Witchcraft and Wizardry. Godric Gryffindor was the most accomplished dueler of his time, an enlightened fighter against Muggle discrimination, and the first owner of the celebrated Sorting Hat. That's so neat. Wait a second. I don't think I read the actual back of this card. Did I? Okay, it's a little thick. It's a thick boy. I feel like such a kid again. It's a holographic, like, do you see that? Whoa, does he do something else? Yeah, no, he's just moving. Oh, is that the sword? I don't know. You guys, is that that sword that Harry uses to fight the basilisks? Silica? Like, not a church, girl. The basilisks? Okay, that's enough. Let's get back to it. Oh my gosh, you can use this as a credit card. Sometimes I wonder what's wrong with me. Okay, we're gonna use this as a bookmark. How cool is that? I don't think I could eat that frog. Okay, seriously, I can't. Okay, here we go. Harry felt in the pocket of his robes and pulled out a chocolate frog, the very last one from the box Hermione had given him for Christmas. He gave it to Neville, who looked as though he might cry. You're worth 12 of Malfoy, said... That's so sweet. What a great friend, Harry said. So he said, you're worth 12 of Malfoy. The Sorting Hat chose you for Gryffindor, didn't it? And where is Malfoy? In stinking Slytherin. Neville's lips twitched in a weak smile as he unwrapped the frog. Thanks, Harry. I think I'll go to bed. Do you want the card? You collect them, don't you? As Neville walked away, Harry looked at the famous wizard card. Dumbledore again, he said. He was the first one I ever... He gasped. He stared at the back of the card, then he looked up at Ron and Hermione. I found him, he whispered. I found Flamel. I told you I'd read the name somewhere before. I read it on the train coming here. Listen to this. Dumbledore is particularly famous for his defeat of the dark wizard Grindelwald in 1945, for the discovery of the 12 uses of dragon's blood, and his work on alchemy with his partner, Nicholas Flamel. Hermione jumped to her feet. She hadn't looked so excited since they'd gotten back the marks for their very first piece of homework. Stay there, she said, and she sprinted up the stairs to the girls' dormitories. Harry and Ron barely had time to exchange mystified looks before she was dashing back an enormous old book in her arms. I never thought to look in here, she whispered excitedly. I got this out of the library weeks ago for a bit of light reading. That's light reading, girl? Shut up. Oh god, Ron said, light? But Hermione told him to be quiet until she'd looked something up and started flicking frantically through the pages, muttering to herself. At last, she found what she was looking for.
I knew it. Are we allowed to speak yet? Said Ron grumpily.
Hermione ignored him.
Nicholas Flamel, she whispered dramatically, is the only known maker of the Sorcerer's Stone.
This didn't have quite the effect she'd expected.
The what? Said Harry and Ron. Oh, honestly.
Don't you two read?
Look. Read that. There.
She pushed the book toward them, and Harry and Ron read.
The ancient study of alchemy is concerned with making the Sorcerer's Stone a legendary substance with astonishing powers. The stone will transform any metal into pure gold. It also produces the elixir of life, which will make the drinker immortal. There have been many reports of the Sorcerer's Stone over the centuries, but the only stone currently in existence belongs to Mr. Nicholas Flamel, the noted alchemist and opera lover. Mr. Flamel, who celebrated his 665th birthday last year, enjoys a quiet life in Devon with his wife, Perenelle, 658. Alright, a little cougar action there, huh? Wow, that's a pretty name, Perenelle. Pernell. It could become real ghetto if you say it in a certain way. Would you guys say Perenelle? Perenelle, Perenelle. It's very pretty. See, said Hermione, when Harry and Ron had finished. The dog must be guarding Flamel's Sorcerer's Stone. I bet he's asked Dumbledore to keep it safe for him because they're friends and he knew someone was after it. That's why he wanted the stone removed out of Gringotts. A stone that makes gold and stops you from ever dying, said Harry. No wonder Snape's after it. Anyone would want it. And no wonder we couldn't find Flamel in that study of recent developments in wizardry, said Ron. He's not exactly recent if he's 665, is he? So fun. Okay, guys, I just checked and we only have a couple pages to go before the end of the chapter. I'm so freaking elated that I decided to just do one chapter per video to like minimize everything. So I'm on page 220 and in this chapter we have up till 227, which is just great. So I will be stopping here. I think I'm going to do a couple little activities. First and foremost, we have to do a little Oculus Reparo because I don't know if you can tell, I'm wearing some new glasses, okay? And my other ones, they broke. So maybe if I feel confident enough, I might pop out the lenses out of the frame of the broken ones. We might do that together on camera for funsies. And then, of course, y'all already know. There's, of course, we're gonna be cooking something. I forget what it's called. Let me quickly look up the name so that way you guys have it and kind of know what it might look like, how it's supposed to look, and we'll see how it turns out. I'll be taking you guys into the kitchen and we'll be doing a little bit of baking. It's supposed to be like a meringue type of almondy, vanilla-y dessert. It's supposed to be very easy, just a few minimal ingredients, trying to make my life as easy as possible, and we'll be getting into that. So let me quickly get the name so that way I have that down. Okay, so I just looked it up. So the official name is the Swedish Visiting House Cakes. House Visiting Cakes, something like that. Oh my gosh. What's wrong with me? Anyway, let's get into fixing the glasses and head on to the kitchen so we can bake away. It's a lot hotter than I thought. All right, that doesn't seem to work. Trying to take off the lenses out of these wireframe glasses, which is just very interesting. I've never had that happen. It kind of works a little bit better, I guess, for glasses like this, where you can just kind of like pop in, pop out. You have to be very careful in the way that you do it. But yeah, I got a bunch of glasses, guys. I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to grab these tiny, tiny little screwdrivers that I bought. I forget why I bought them, but it doesn't hurt to have them since I am an eyeglass wearer. And I am going to take out the little screws that are here. I don't know if you guys can tell. I'm gonna take these little screws out to see if that can help me. So I have like this here. I just bought it off of Amazon. I'll link it below if you guys need me to. It has a bunch of like little tiny screws and some different screwdrivers. Very small. So let's go ahead and get started with that. Hopefully that works. I don't know. Can you see that? It's lifting. It's so tiny. I don't want to lose the... Oh my god. I almost lost it. I had to remove the second screw. I'm gonna be very careful. Not that I even need to like be careful with them because I have another pair of Ray-Bans here with screws. But anyway, yes! I did it! I did it! This needs some serious cleaning. Woohoo!
Oculus Reparo.
I definitely need to remember that one.
I first started by greasing with, not butter as the recipe calls for, but I greased this with
ham, sprayed it, and then lined my 9-inch square pan with parchment paper. And now, let's go ahead and preheat the oven to 300. I'm still learning how to use this thing. And you see the gradation here? It's from the, yeah, I gotta wipe it all down. It's from the grout. I was like, why is that taking so long to say? Like, okay. Yeah, it's from the grout. Yeah, the guy's coming today to continue, you guys. Ah, the kitchen's almost done. Okay, I'm going to leave this here and get started with the topping. So I don't feel like using the electric whisk that I have. It's a KitchenAid, cute little thing. So I'm just gonna use this one and hope for the best. So we're gonna add sugar, eggs, and salt together until it's all nice and pale and light in color. So let's go ahead and do that. That looks interesting. The corners look pretty good to you. Let me go ahead and stick something in here to see if it's clipped all the way. Oh shoot, you hear that? A little bit still, I think. I think I'm gonna leave it for another 4-ish minutes. Close that up. Yeah, 4 more minutes. maybe three. I'm ready to taste my creation. Let's see how it is. This is quite exciting. This is such a beautiful dessert that looks like you took a lot of time, but this is one of the easiest things I've ever done for the channel, besides like Vernon's brandy. So let's see here. It's pretty like spongy on the inside, like it's moist. And then the upper crust, the upper layer is kind of like a meringue-y, crispier like version of the cake. So let's go ahead and try. Okay, here we go. I don't know why I'm always so nervous. There's nothing to be nervous of. You know exactly what you put in there, don't you? Oh man, my mom would kill for this. She would love this. I'm going to make this when I come back. This is so good. It tastes very expensive. I think it's just almond in general. Whoa, y'all, make this. This is delicious. Oh my goodness. Very moist, very chewy. I just, you know, when I was mixing it, the butter with the rest of the batter, I was like, this is gonna be okay. And I wasn't sure, but you know how the people always say, trust the process, trust the process. I'm like, okay. This is so good, you guys. It is like the Frenchiest French chef has made this, or it feels like a hobbit during the dead of winter in his cabin has made this. So this is Swedish Visiting Cakes. So fast, so delicious, and it's not too sweet either. Oh my gosh, that's another thing. It's not as sweet. It has a perfect almondy taste, and I don't really love almond. It's kind of crazy to have something that's like coated in almonds, but it's so, so good. You guys, that was one of the best cakes I've ever had. Dumbledore would like this. McGonagall would like this. Snape would definitely like this too. It tastes so expensive and exquisite. It feels like very custom and luxurious. Like it just tastes like so good. I don't know how else to describe it, but oh my God. You can have it with a cup of coffee. You could even put some ice cream on there if you really wanted to get a little fancy, a little affogato kind of style, but oh. You guys, this is very Harry Potter-esque, and I had to come back and just say how delicious it was. I'm definitely making this again. Just amazing. Like, it was delicious. Just scrumptious. The next morning, in defense against the dark arts, while copying down different ways of treating werewolf bites, Harry and Ron were still discussing what they'd do with a sorcerer's stone if they had one. It wasn't until Ron said he'd buy his own Quidditch team that Harry remembered about Snape and the coming match. I'm going to play, he said Ron and Hermione. If I don't, all the Slytherins will think I'm just too scared to face Snape. I'll show them. It'll really wipe the smiles off their faces if we win. Just as long as we're not wiping you off the field, said Hermione. As the match drew nearer, however, Harry became more and more nervous, whatever he told Ron and Hermione. The rest of the team wasn't too calm either. The idea of overtaking Slytherin in the house championship was wonderful. No one had done it for 7 years, but would they be allowed to with such a biased referee? I would have killed to see Snape refereeing a Quidditch match because I just think it humanizes him a little bit more. He's like more in the dirt with the children instead of being in a commanding position such as a professor of a classroom, you know? So yeah, I think that would have been really, really cool. Harry didn't, which is just great. I love these books for that very reason, because it's like, that was not in the movie. It's always, I think it's Madam Hooch. Now I want a nice clean game. Okay, let's continue. So it says here, Harry didn't know whether he was imagining it or not, but he seemed to keep running into Snape wherever he went. At times, he even wondered whether Snape was following him, trying to catch him on his own. Potions lessons were turning into a sort of weekly torture. Snape was so horrible to Harry. Could Snape possibly know they'd found out about the Sorcerer's Stone? Harry didn't see how he could.
Yet he sometimes had the horrible feeling that Snape could read minds. Harry knew, when they wished him good luck outside the locker rooms the next afternoon, that Ron and Hermione were wondering whether they'd ever see him alive again. This wasn't what you'd call comforting. Harry hardly heard a word of Wood's pep talk as he pulled on his Quidditch robes and picked up his Nimbus 2000. Ron and Hermione, meanwhile, had found a place in the stands next to Neville, who couldn't understand why they looked so grim and worried, or why they had both brought their wands to the match, just in case we need to do some lighting of the professor's robe again. Little did Harry know that Ron and Hermione had been secretly practicing the leg lock curse. Oh, they'd gotten the idea from Malfoy using it on Neville and were ready to use it on Snape if he showed any sign of wanting to hurt Harry. Now don't forget, it's locomotor mortis. Okay, so you're like rigor mortis, like stiff and loco mortar, no movement. Hermione muttered as Ron slipped his wand up his sleeve, like a little sleight of hand, poker style. I know, Ron snapped. Don't nag. Back in the locker room, Wood had taken Harry aside. Don't want to pressure you, Potter, but if we ever need an early capture of the snitch, it's now. Finish the game before Snape can favor Hufflepuff too much. The whole school's out there, said Fred Weasley, peering out of the door. Even Blimey, Dumbledore's come to watch. Harry's heart did a somersault. Dumbledore? He said, dashing to the door to make sure. Fred was right. There was no mistaking that silver beard. Harry could have laughed out loud with relief. He was safe. There was simply no way that Snape would dare to try to hurt him if Dumbledore was watching. I've said this before. I love characters who just make you feel wholeheartedly safe and sound and protected. I am telling you, there's nothing like it. I just love watching like TV or reading books that just feel like, okay, this person is like almost the equivalent of a, you know, like just a god, a protector, you know? So it's like, oh, I'm safe and sound if the so-and-so is here. Superman is here, it's okay. You know what I mean? Like that. So I just love that. It's the same thing that I said about Aslan in The Chronicles of Narnia. Yes, relieved. Okay, perhaps that's why Snape was looking so angry as the teams marched onto the field. Something that Ron noticed too. I've never seen Snape look so mean, he told Hermione. Look, they're off. Ouch! Someone had poked Ron in the back of the head. It was Malfoy. Oh, sorry, Weasley. Didn't see you there. Malfoy grinned broadly at Crabbe and Goyle. Wonder how long Potter's gonna stay on his broom this time. Anyone wanna bet? What about you, Weasley? Ron didn't answer. Snape had just awarded Hufflepuff a penalty because George Weasley had hit a bludger at him. Hermione, who had all her fingers crossed in her lap, was squinting fixedly at Harry, who was circling the game like a hawk, looking for the snitch. You know how I think they choose people for the Gryffindor team, said Malfoy loudly a few minutes later as Snape awarded Hufflepuff another penalty for no reason at all. Okay. It's people they feel sorry for. See, there's Potter, who's got no parent. Then there's the Weasleys, who've got no money. You should be on the team. Longbottom, you've got no brains. Neville went bright red, but turned in his seat to face Malfoy. I'm worth 12 of you, Malfoy, he stammered. I love that. That's right. Have your friends prop you up. Like, you do your affirmations, Neville. You are amazing. You're beautiful. You're brave. You're Gryffindor.
Now look in this mirror and tell me again what you see.
Well, I see...
Pride!
Pride!
Power!
Power! I see...
A badass mother who
won't take no crap off of nobody!
Again!
I see pride!
That's so cute. I'm worth 12 of you, Malfoy. Ooh! Great comeback. It's like, Harry's words stuck with him, which is just great. Malfoy, Crabbe, and Goyle howled with laughter, but Ron, still not daring to take his eyes from the game, said, "You tell him, Neville." Longbottom, if brains were gold, you'd be poorer than Weasley, and that's saying something. Ron's nerves were already stretched to the breaking point with anxiety about Harry.
I'm warning you, Malfoy. One more word. Ron, said Hermione suddenly.
Harry!
What? Where?
Harry had suddenly gone into a spectacular dive, which drew gasps and cheers from the crowd. Hermione stood up, her crossed fingers in her mouth, as Harry streaked toward the ground like a bullet.
You're in luck, Weasley. Potter's obviously spotted some money on the ground, said Malfoy.
What a jerk. Ron snapped. Before Malfoy knew what was coming, Ron was on top of him, wrestling him to the ground. Neville hesitated, then clambered over the back of his seat to help.
Come on, Harry!
Hermione screamed, leaping onto her seat to watch as Harry sped straight at Snape. She didn't even notice Malfoy and Ron rolling around under her seat, or the scuffles and yelps coming from the whirl of fists that was Neville, Crabbe, and Goyle. Up in the air, Snape turned on his broomstick just in time to see something. I'm trying to think. Have I ever seen Snape on a broomstick? Okay. So he turned on his broomstick just in time to see something scarlet shoot past him, missing him by inches. The next second, Harry had pulled out of the dive, his arm raised in triumph, the snitched clasped in his hand. The stands erupted. It had to be a record. No one could ever remember the snitch being caught so quickly.
Ron! Ron, where are you? The game's over! Harry's won! We've won! Gryffindor was in the lead!
Shrieked Hermione, dancing up and down on her seat and hugging Pavarti Patil in the row in front. Harry jumped off his broom a foot from the ground. He couldn't believe it. He'd done it. The game was over. It had barely lasted 5 minutes. As Gryffindors came spilling onto the field, he saw Snape land nearby, white-faced and tight-lipped. Then Harry felt a hand on his shoulder and looked up into Dumbledore's smiling face.
Well done, said Dumbledore quietly, so that only Harry could hear. Nice to see you haven't been brooding about that mare. Been keeping busy. Excellent.
Snape spat bitterly on the ground. Sorry about the change in lighting. I have a lot of external factors that I'm dealing with, from the radiator, which makes a crazy sound. But of course, if I am filming and you can hear that, it's not good. And then also the sun is shifting and it's winter, so it goes away much, much faster than I would like. So let's go ahead and continue here. I literally have about 2.5 pages to read and then we're done. I am so happy we're doing one chapter per video now. Okay, let's go. Harry left the locker room alone sometime later to take his Nimbus 2000 back to the broom shed. He couldn't ever remember feeling happier. He'd really done something to be proud of now. No one could say he was just a famous name anymore. The evening air had never smelled so sweet. He walked over the damp grass, reliving the last hour in his head, which was a happy blur. Gryffindors running to lift him onto their shoulders, Ron and Hermione in the distance, jumping up and down, Ron cheering through a heavy nosebleed. Harry had reached the shed. He leaned against the wooden door and looked up at Hogwarts with its windows glowing red in the setting sun. Gryffindor in the lead. He'd done it. He'd shown Snape. And speaking of Snape, a hooded figure came swiftly down the front steps of the castle. Clearly not wanting to be seen, it walked as fast as possible towards the Forbidden Forest, just as I suspected. Harry's victory faded from his mind as he watched. He recognized the figure's prowling walk. Snape, sneaking into the forest while everyone else was at dinner. What was going on? Harry jumped back on his Nimbus 2000 and took off. Gliding silently over the castle, he saw Snape enter the forest at a run. He followed. The trees were so thick he couldn't see where Snape had gone. He flew in circles, lower and lower, brushing the top branches of trees until he heard voices. He glided toward them and landed noiselessly in a towering beech tree. He climbed carefully along one of the branches, holding tight to his broomstick, trying to see through the leaves. Below, in a shadowy clearing, stood Snape, but he wasn't alone. Quirrell was there too. Harry couldn't make out the look on his face, but he was stuttering worse than ever. Ugh, that guy's so weird. Like, as I said, like, you got something in your head. Like, a head in your... So disturbing. Okay, I was trying to get comfortable. Harry strained to catch what they were saying. Don't know why you wanted to meet here, of all places, Severus. Oh, I thought we'd keep this private, said Snape, his voice icy. Students aren't supposed to know about the Sorcerer's Stone, after all. Harry leaned forward. Quirrell was mumbling something. Snape interrupted him. Have you found out how to get past that beast of Hagrid's yet? Severus, you don't want me as your enemy, Quirrell, said Snape, taking a step toward him. I don't know what you know perfectly well what I mean. An owl hooted loudly, and Harry nearly fell out of the tree. He steadied himself in time to hear Snape say, you're a little bit of hocus pocus. I'm waiting. I don't. Very well, Snape cut in. We'll have another little chat soon when you've had time to think things over and decided where your loyalties lie.
his loyalties. He threw his cloak over his head and strode out of the clearing. It was almost dark now, but Harry could see Quirrell standing quite still as though he was petrified.
Harry, where have you been? Hermione squeaked.
We won! You won! We won! Shouted Ron, thumping Harry on the back. And I gave Malfoy a black eye, and Neville tried to take on Crabbe and Goyle single-handed. He's still out cold, but Madame Pomfrey says he'll be all right. Talk about showing Slytherin, everyone's waiting for you in the common room. We're having a party. Fred and George stole some cakes and stuff from the kitchens. That's why I wanted to make a cake this episode of Harry Potter. Never mind that now, said Harry breathlessly. Let's find an empty room. You wait till you hear this. He made sure Peeves wasn't inside before shutting the door behind them. Then he told them what he'd seen and heard. So we were right. It is the Sorcerer's Stone. And Snape's trying to force Quirrell to help him get it. He asked if he knew how to get past Fluffy. And he said something about Quirrell's hocus pocus. I reckon there are other things guarding the stone apart from Fluffy. Loads of enchantments, probably. And Quirrell would have done some anti-dark arts spell that Snape needs to break through. So you mean the stone's only safe as long as Quirrell stands up to Snape? Said Hermione in alarm.
It'll be gone by next Tuesday, said Ron.
That's it. Page 227. Ah, I'm so happy. I'm done. Not as if it's really a chore, obviously. I love reading this book, but it really was a feat trying to squeeze in multiple chapters in one episode. So yeah, the very next one is chapter 14, Norbert the Norwegian Ridgeback. So maybe a dragon? Yeah, it looks like a dragon. I can't wait to get into that as well. Full disclosure, guys. I haven't made the cake just yet, okay? So again, a little Inception, time jump, time warp, a little bit of a Twilight Zone. I haven't made the cake yet, so I have no idea how that's gonna go. I'm gonna insert it, of course, in the middle of the video so that way it can be very cohesive, but I just want to let you guys know that. But yeah, I am so happy that we got another chapter down. I can't wait for Norbert the Norwegian Hunchback of Notre Dame. Anyway, as I was saying, yeah, super excited about that. We're going to try to do like a Norwegian type of stew or soup next time. I've already planned it out. Just by the title of it, I'm not really gonna go by what's in the book at this point in time. So that way I can help myself kind of better prepare. But yes, thank you so much for watching. I hope that you guys enjoyed the video and I can't wait to come back and read more with y'all. Leave me a comment below about what you thought of this chapter. And if you have any questions or comments, you know, just leave them down below and I'll be more than happy to interact with you guys. I'll catch you guys in my very next one. Bye.
Saw you in the park on Wednesday. You were dressed for sunshine.